Let's pray as we give this time to him. Lord, thank you for who you are. Lord, I have the words of the song that we just sang going through my mind. And what a sweet thing as we realize we call and you answer. You come to our rescue. We truly want to be where you are. And so tonight as we get into your word, we ask that you would speak to us and that you would be the one who's glorified. You would be the one who draws us near. And Lord, that those things that we've been going through this week, this month, even this first quarter of this year, you would help us to be hungry for hearing from you. And not just hearing, but responding in obedience as we look at that person who's satisfied. So we thank you and we pray your blessing upon our time tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. We find ourselves tonight in Psalm 16. Years ago, we used to live in California. And yes, a little bit about me, I should probably share that. I got saved in 1989 at Calvary Chapel in Downey, California. It was not too far from Long Beach area in LA County. And I was sitting in the front row and there was a concert going on. And when the preacher, you know, shared the gospel, it was almost as if the Lord was saying, hey, listen, I give you a front row seat so you didn't have to walk all the way from the back. You know you need me. So I accepted the Lord and started growing in the Lord and serving at Downey for many years. That's where I met my wife, and we had our three kids there. And then we felt like the Lord was calling us to take over a fellowship that was in Idaho. And we were there for about 3 years, and I was talking with my pastor, and he said, hey, you know, why don't you come on back? I really need some help here. And so we, after praying about it and just kind of waiting on the Lord for a while, we went back to Downey. And yet during that time, I just felt like the Lord still wanted to do something in terms of planting a church or taking over a fellowship or whatever he had in mind. I was just open because we felt like he was calling us to go out. And so as we were praying for about 4 years, Colorado just kept coming up. And then we actually looked at the baby dedication for our youngest son before we went to Idaho. And it was interesting because Pastor Jeff prayed for him and he said, as they go to Idaho, and we thought, oh, wow, okay, maybe it is Colorado, Lord. You've planned that all along. And so we've been out here for the last 5.5 years planting in the city of Louisville, and it's been a wonderful and challenging and stretching and growing experience. But while we were in California, we had some family members that wanted to go to the museum, and so we went to the J. Paul Getty Museum years ago, and it was a nice experience, and I remember just enjoying some of the paintings that were there from many famous painters that we had heard about over the years. And as time went by, we kind of had to quicken our pace. And so one painting I actually got to spend time with and take a look at was a painting that was a self-portrait by the Impressionist painter Edgar Degas. And as I was looking at it, The caption said that he was 23 years old when he painted it. And I thought, okay, well, I'm not much of an art critic, so I don't know, you know, what to make of it, except the caption is what caught my eye. And it said, quote, "The small-scale informal presentation emphasizes the intimacy of this image and the still tentative character of the young artist." And that phrase just kind of stuck out. Here was a portrait of a person who painted himself in the mirror what he looked like when no one was around. And what other people saw was a young person who was tentative in his character. That's the word that stuck out. It's a word that means unsure or uncertain or hesitant. And it made me wonder, you know, if we were to sit all alone and we were just to look at what we are in terms of, like, in the mirror or in the mirror of God's word, what kind of expression or what kind of self-portrait would be the natural result, the byproduct of our relationship with the Lord? What would that look like if you were to sit in front of a mirror tonight and say, you know, this is the way I come across when no one else is around? The psalm we're going to take a look at tonight is David's self-portrait. And through this, we're going to see how he was a believer who was satisfied in his relationship with the Lord. Have you ever had a meal like I was talking about, my friend Patrick? Man, he wolfed down those pancakes because he had an appetite. But after he ate, oh man, he was satisfied. It was almost like nap time, you know? It's kind of like my son. He's 13 years old. And no matter where we are, if we go to a restaurant and we eat dinner, you know what he's doing after he eats? He's like, oh, let me just lay down a little bit here. He just kind of lays out. I'm like, son, sit up. We're in a public place, you know? And I think that's kind of a good thing when it comes to our walk with the Lord. So this evening, we're going to take a look at three areas. We're going to look at the perspective of a satisfied believer. We're going to look at the portion of the satisfied believer. And lastly, we're going to look at the path of the satisfied believer. But let's look at verses 1-4 as we take a look at this, as we see what he has for us. He says in verse 1, "Preserve me, O God, for in you I put my trust. O my soul, you've said to the Lord, you are my Lord. My goodness is nothing apart from you. As for the saints who are on the earth, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. Their sorrows shall be multiplied who hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood I will not offer, nor take up their names on my lips." And so there we see it, first four verses. Here we get introduced into what David is talking about. And did you notice even before verse 1 where he says, "Preserve me," it says what kind of a psalm this is. It's a miktam. Now, if you're in Israel, you have to be really heavy with that CH. It's a miktam, you know, of David. And they really get into it. I have a friend who's Egyptian, and whenever I come around, he calls me Habibi, you know, but he lays on the H really thick. "How's it going, Habibi?" And I'm like, "I'm fine, hop," and I just can't do it the way he does it. But it's really thick, and what it means essentially, there's a few theories regarding its origin. It means one of three things. It means to kind of hide or cover, kind of like when you cover your lips while you're praying, almost as if to conceal what you're praying so you can have some sort of privacy. Another understanding of what that means is it could mean an engraving or a sculpture, something that was like a sculptured writing. This was to imply it's a writing that was, though personal in the beginning, was supposed to be engraved for later on, for future generations to read. Or lastly, it was also referred to, it could mean golden. A lot of commentators gravitate towards that because, as we're going to see later on, it's a messianic psalm that's quoted by both Peter in Acts chapter 2, and later on in Acts chapter 13, Paul quotes it as well on his first missionary journey. As a matter of fact, Peter said, speaking of Acts 2:26, he said, "For you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption." That's where he's referring to the messianic element of that. But there's five miktam psalms, and David was the author of this one. So the first thing I notice, what does it mean to be somebody who is satisfied in the Lord? Well, she first and foremost, is a person who recognizes that they're living in God's presence. Wherever I go, just like David said in Psalm 139, where can I flee from your presence, or where can I go from your spirit? Lord, you're everywhere I go. That requires an element of faith, doesn't it? To be able to see the Lord where you are, just as we were singing earlier tonight, help me to see, Lord, where you are. Help me to see you here, to recognize that. I love what Oswald Chambers said. He says, we can all see God in the exceptional things, can't we? We can see when God does something miraculous and incredible, but it requires the culture of spiritual discipline to see God in every detail. That's what David was praying tonight. He was living in God's presence, and so he saw. And the first thing he says by faith is he says, "Preserve me, O God, for in you I put my trust." He begins with this declaration in faith and this confidence in God's provision for his life. And all the thoughts come from this foundation. Now he's appealing to God for protection over something that he really doesn't identify here. But many people believe that this is possibly when he was fleeing from Saul. And so he's saying, Lord, help me. Maybe he felt like his life was in his hands. And so he's saying, actually, in the Lord's hands, it could have been an ungodly enemy, or even as verse 10 later on shows us, it could have been that he was afraid of dying or dying from an enemy. So he was confident of God's provision. I love this word preserve because it's a word that means to watch over me. Every parent knows what that's like, don't they? You remember when you had your first child? How you were just like walking around with your child like you had a bunch of, you know, styrofoam so they wouldn't hurt themselves. And so, you know, me and my wife as parents, we especially were very careful with our firstborn because she was born 10 weeks premature. It was tough. You know, as the husband, I'm supposed to be there to help my wife and to protect her from those things. And yet the night when our first daughter was born, Lily, she came out and she was weighing 2 pounds, 14 ounces. She looked like a little older person because her skin was so wrinkly and she was so skinny. And I thought, wow, is this right? Is everything okay? She was in the hospital for 6 weeks. And I'll never forget when my wife first left the hospital, we're walking down the corridor and she burst out into tears and she said, this doesn't feel right. Aren't you supposed to be able to take your baby home with you? And that just got to me. So when we got home, she's on this breathing apparatus in case she stopped breathing and we had to make sure we knew CPR. And so we were definitely watching over Lily. And so as time went by, the machine went away because she started getting healthier and healthier. But we're watching them. And that's what David is saying. Lord, watch over me. Would you please kind of hedge me about with thorns? That's what the Hebrew word shamar actually means. It kind of means to guard generally. And that's what shepherds would do with their sheep. Remember, Jesus said that he is the good shepherd. And then he also went to say that he's the door to the sheepfold. So whenever the sheep would get together, he would huddle them together and he would have this huge semicircle or mostly a circle of thorns, a hedge of thorns. And then he would lay in the opening so that anybody who wanted to get to his precious little lambs, they're going to have to go through the shepherd. Remember what David said, you know, hey, when he was trying to prove himself to Saul to give his resume to be able to go out and kill Goliath, he said, hey, you know what? A lion and a bear came after my sheep, but I grabbed it, the lion by its beard, and I took that bad boy out. You know, I'm able to do it. He was definitely up for the task, and our good shepherd as well. So David wanted his constant care, and he says, because the second part, in you I put my trust. And of all the sources that David could have trusted in, he said he put his trust in the Lord. That's what pleased God. That's what the Lord looks for from you and I, just so you know as well. That's what God desires from each and every one of us, is a life that simply says, you know what, Lord, I trust you. I don't see you, I sense you, I know you're here by faith. That's what Hebrews 11:6 says, remember? Without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord. No, you don't understand. Why? Well, I've given so much to the church. That doesn't matter. Well, I've got a pew named after me. Well, that doesn't really matter. Well, I do all these great things. Yes, but do you trust in Jesus for your salvation? Well, I think, you know, God helps those who help themselves. That's in the Bible somewhere, right? Well, yeah, Benjamin Franklin's Bible, but because he's the one who said that. But God loves it when we trust. And I'll tell you what, I don't know about you guys, but in my life, I go back and forth from trusting in the Lord to trusting in myself so much. And the Lord has to kind of convict me and kind of smack me upside the head a little bit, you know? Hey, what's going on here? I thought you trusted me. Yeah, I did, Lord, but I thought, oh, okay, I need to get back on track. It's not a good combination. We like to trust in the Lord while we're going through difficult things because we have no idea how it's going to work out, do we? And then when we're on the other side of the trial, we start to kind of get back into our own groove. Okay, God, I've got it. Thanks, Lord. You know, you're my co-pilot, Lord. Thanks so much for taking over. Now I can handle it from here. But listen, trusting in the Lord and then trusting in yourself, they don't go well together. It's kind of like when I was younger, my grandmother was a wonderful, sweet, and godly woman. She loved me. She would tell me about Jesus all the time. But in spite of all her love for me, in spite of the fact that she cared for me and she would make me lunch, the sad thing was when she made me lunch, she said, oh, I'm going to make you something you'll really enjoy. I'll make your favorite sandwich. I said, oh, okay. So she would make me peanut butter and mayonnaise sandwiches. What I didn't realize is that Grandma was raised in the Depression. And so that was my experience as well, after having peanut butter and mayonnaise sandwich. Some things don't go well together. You can do peanut butter and jelly. That's great. You can do milk and cookies. That's wonderful. Peanut butter and mayonnaise are a big no. And so I was like, oh. And she was so sweet about it. She would cut it in a certain way so it kind of looked like a butterfly. And she had great presentation. I had chips and all that. But that first bite, I knew something is seriously wrong here, right? It was not a great experience. But I'll tell you what, it was a memorable experience. Oh, man. But that's the way we are. We trust in the Lord and then we trust in ourselves. Those two things are incompatible. But then David goes on and he says in verse 2, oh, my soul, you've said to the Lord, you are my Lord. My goodness is nothing apart from you. That phrase, you are my Lord, you're my master, you are my ruler, you are the one who is in control. But you know what's interesting? In our culture, we don't like that terminology, do we? We don't like the terminology of referring to somebody as a master or as a ruler. And it's understandable given our history. Whether it harkens back to the dark period with slavery or even further back in ancient world history, we see examples of tyrannical rulers of different civilizations. But that wasn't what David's experience with God was like. David recognized something about the Lord that made him gladly want to be God's servant. He wanted to call God his Lord and master, especially in contrast with those who pursued other gods. Verse 4, he said, though their sorrows are going to be multiplied who hasten or rush after another god, another idol. And we're going to talk about that in a minute. So I thought that was interesting. He wanted to call the Lord his ruler. I want to have that mindset as well. And that it makes me just continuously and automatically relate to the Lord as my master in all of my life. And I know we say that as Christians. Well, are you a Christian? Well, yes, Jesus is my Lord and Savior. But then stop sometimes and say, if somebody were to look at my life, judging by my attitude and my actions, do I respond and live this life as if Jesus is my Lord? Because you've heard the saying before, if he's not Lord of all, then he's not Lord at all. So Lord, search me and help me to see. So what is your impression of God? If you were to call the Lord one thing by your actions, would you say, well, you know, oh my soul, you've said to the Lord, you are my, you fill in the blank. Would you refer to God as your good buddy? As I mentioned, your co-pilot? Or do you kind of carry that mindset that maybe you had growing up of God? Maybe it was an altered, incorrect understanding of who God was. Maybe kind of like me, I was raised without knowing my biological father. And so that whole area of what does it mean to have a father-son relationship, there was for the longest time, just kind of an emptiness and understanding. And so I thought, well, God is just this big authoritarian figure. And then the Lord took me to Psalm 27:10. When my mother and my father forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. He began to fill that void of understanding and show me, no, it's not this big ogre, it's this loving, caring, masculine, strong, but sensitive father to me. And so however we see the Lord is going to determine how we respond to him. Now, David goes on, he says, my goodness is nothing apart from you. In other words, without Jesus, we have no goodness on our own. David said he has no well-being apart from God, but then the flip is also true. The opposite is true for us as well. With Jesus, we have everything we need. The question is, do you and I kind of run around and act like we don't? Remember what Jesus said, David said in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. Consequently, what? I shall not want. And Lord, you're taking care of everything I need. And so there's a contentment that I have in you. Would you say tonight you're experiencing that contentment in the Lord, that soul satisfaction in Jesus Christ? Or is there something that's coming along and kind of robbing that? Because David recognized in Jesus, there's everything I need. I don't know if you ever heard the story about the wealthy Roman official, but he lived many, many years ago, and he had a very capable servant named Marcellus. But he also had a son who was kind of a disappointment to him. He had high hopes for this son. He wanted him to go into government and then be possibly emperor one day. And yet his son had different aspirations altogether. It's not that he was bad. It's just he wasn't following his dad's path. And so after a certain amount of time, the father passed away. And when his will was opened, it was found that he had left all of his estate to his servant Marcellus, the slave. His will decreed, however, that his son could just choose one thing among all of the items that the father owned from the estate before his will was settled. After looking around and walking through the house and years of memories from things his father had purchased and collected, the son went back to the person who was handling the estate and he said, well, I've considered the one item I want from my father. Because you're saying that everything is going to Marcellus except I can have one thing, correct? The attorney said, well, that's correct. And he said, okay, well, the one thing I want then is Marcellus. And in having Marcellus, he had everything in his father's house. And I think the same thing is true in us. Though we were born in sin, though we were born apart from the Lord and we have no goodness or well-being on our own, yet when we not only have the Lord as believers, but we walk in the Lord, practically speaking, then we start to realize, Lord, you are my good shepherd. Therefore, I don't have to want anything. You realize that contentment is something that we have to learn. It doesn't happen naturally. And so if you find out, you're saying, Brent, I want to be content in the Lord, but this and that and the other thing. Well, Paul said in Philippians chapter 4, I've learned in whatever state I am to be content. Do you feel like there's a trial that keeps coming up over and over again? And the Lord keeps allowing those things to come through your life so that you can rest in him, so that he can be your everything. You'll be amazed at what the kind of peace the Lord can bring in your life as you just look to him alone. Not Jesus but Jesus alone. And so then he says in verse 3, he says, as for the saints who are on the earth, they're the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. And now here's something I love what I see David declaring here, because I feel like the church today in our culture is missing. Fellowship was essential. He's now showing that one of the elements of being a satisfied person is not just living in God's presence, but it's living among God's people. Fellowship is essential to our walk if we want to be satisfied. It was one of the secrets of spiritual growth of the first church. You can take a look at it later. Write it down in Acts 2:42. The Bible says the church continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and prayers. See, fellowship builds strong personal relationships. A major part of David's source of satisfaction was that fellowship. If you look at the label he gives God's people, you can tell it wasn't just something he did because it was a routine. He didn't say, yeah, I go to church. You can always tell when somebody's excited about something or not, right? I go to church. It's been a while, so I ran into a guy years ago at this fast food restaurant. He hadn't been to church for a while. And you could tell just by his reaction when he saw me that he had been out of fellowship. And there was that kind of awkwardness. You know what happens? He was like, oh, hey, how's it going? And I'm like, hey, so-and-so, I haven't seen you forever. And I genuinely missed him. I was like, he was with someone else, so I didn't want to embarrass him by using all the Christian vernacular. Hey, bro, I haven't seen you in fellowship, or whatever the case may be. But I just wanted to kind of ease into it and just kind of see where he was coming from. And I said, so, how's life in Christ? And this was the telltale sign of where he was with the Lord. He goes, it's good. I mean, he hasn't killed me yet. And I was like, what? Hasn't killed me. And I just tried to play it off like, oh, okay, I'll catch up. All right, well, that's good. He hasn't killed you yet. But hopefully I'll see you at church soon, It was so amazing. Paul had spent time caring and loving people that were in the church in Ephesus. And if you have a moment to write it down, I would encourage you to do so. Acts chapter 20, in verses 37 through 38. I'm going to turn there real quick if you want to go with me. Look at the way this fellowship was, or the characteristics of this fellowship. Now, we all know it as Paul's pastoral conference, if you will, the meeting he had with the Ephesian elders on Miletus. But he shares all these things with them, and at the very end of this short Bible study, the Bible tells us in verse 37 and 38, let's back up to verse 36. It says, when he said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. Then they all wept freely, and they fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words which he spoke, that they would see his face no more. I'm going to miss my brother with whom I've had so much closeness. He's helped me to grow in the Lord. He's encouraged me. He's invested into my life and I in him. And I'll tell you something tonight. If fellowship is an element that you find lacking in your life, man, I would say examine where your heart's coming from. Because sometimes we try to pull back from fellowship because we've been hurt by other believers. And I'll tell you this right now. It's going to continue. That's the byproduct of loving somebody. Naturally, when you love someone, you risk the possibility of being hurt. You risk the possibility of being burned. And you know what? When we come in here, when you see others, here's what I encourage you to do the next time you see somebody who's burned, who's been hurt. You know how you'll notice them? There's that sense of unforgiveness that comes in their conversation. The way they talk, the way they relate. They're a little standoffish. They kind of do the college, Heisman Trophy look. They kind of do one of these when they talk to you. They're like, hey, yeah, that's great. I just, you do your thing and I'll do my thing. There's that, I don't want to be hurt again. But I'll tell you what, you risk being hurt because that's where genuine fellowship comes in. And without that, you're just going through the motions. And so if tonight, maybe that characterizes you, that describes you, and you're saying, I don't feel satisfied in you, Lord. Well, it's because you've been trying to manufacture the outward experience without truly surrendering and saying, Lord, help me to forgive and then help me to dive back into fellowship as well. Somebody once said, show me your friends and I'll show you your future. Who you spend the most time with reveals whether you're wanting to fellowship with God's people or the world. I always come across somebody invariably when I say something like this, and they'll come up to me afterwards and they'll say, well, Pastor Brent, I think that's great for most Christians, but I'm just not the fellowshipping type. I'm like, God and I, we just have this relationship. We understand one another. I kind of see myself like a spiritual lone ranger. That's the way I am. I just kind of share and I move on. I ride off into the sunset. Yeah, but you know what? Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto, okay? So when it came to fellowship, I think we need to understand that. And a genuine response of being a believer is that we will love the brothers. John says in 1 John 3:14, we know that we've passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. He's saying, hey, if you don't genuinely love God's people, many people say, well, I love God. It's just those Christians that are kind of out there. So, you know, no, that's part of it. Welcome to the family, baby. You know, you're a part of it as well. You don't get to choose your family. And you know what? Get used to it because you're going to see them for eternity. You know what the thing is, though? They have to deal with you for eternity as well. It's not a bad thing. Fellowship is a litmus test. I think sometimes when we have a deficiency, we're the last to know it. God wants to help us to be aware. So not only does fellowship among God's people create a satisfied believer, but a satisfied believer also lives by godly principles. Go back with me to Psalm 16. So he says, their sorrows shall be multiplied who hasten after another God. David knew the source of going from satisfied to sorrowful. David had boundaries in his relationship with the Lord. And I think that's something we need to just always be mindful of. Do you realize in Psalm 1, the psalm is about what? About the way of the righteous and the way of the ungodly contrasted, right? But when he talks about what do the godly people look like, he talks about it in the negative three times. They walk not in the counsel of the ungodly. They don't stand in the path of the sinners. They don't sit in the seat of the scornful. Oh, Brent, you're being really negative about what it means to be a Christian. Well, I'll tell you what. There's a lot of things that I have to enjoy health by not doing. When my kids were younger, whenever they first started walking, the place my wife and I were always, we were doing like football, zone coverage, you know. We had three kids, so it was two against three. And we had to be careful whenever they would go into the kitchen and mom was cooking. And so we'd have to say, ooh, it's hot, don't touch, it'll hurt the baby, you know. And so we'd make these big expressions. And my girls were like, oh, hot, no, I don't want to touch. They're so cute. And then my boy was like, hot? I'm supposed to? This is the face I'm getting? Oh, you know, and once burned, once bitten, twice as shy. David knew that there needed to be those boundaries of not going after other things. You know why? Because it hit his family. Later on, his son Solomon. The Bible says in 1 Kings 11:4, when Solomon was old, it happened that his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not loyal to the Lord his God, as was the heart of his father David. Oh, can you imagine the pain that David would have experienced had he known? Oh, he went through a lot with Absalom already. But had he known that his very son that he was writing these words for and many others would go down that path. You read the book of Ecclesiastes, and you know what his conclusion is? It's Ecclesiastes is the wisdom of a foolish person. It's all vanity. It's all empty. Until you get to the very end, where you fear God and keep his commandments, he said. So, do you have things that guard your relationship with the Lord? You realize that God may tell you there's certain things that are out of bounds that other Christians might totally be able to enjoy. But for you, the Lord says, hey, off limits. We had our men's study last Saturday, and I thought this was great. One of the men was saying, you know, I couldn't understand why the Lord was telling me this, but I distinctly remember him telling me, I don't want you to be watching Star Trek. And I was like, a little bit of a geek here with the Star Trek. And so I thought, and I was like waiting to see what did he do, you know? No Star Trek. Well, I mean, God and Star Trek is way down. Yeah, okay, that makes sense. And so it was one of those things, but he realized that he needed to have that boundary and he needed to exercise that obedience when the Lord showed him that wasn't for him. And you know, if you and I continue to cultivate a behavior pattern of obeying when the Lord says stay away, you know what's going to take place is when temptations or trials come in, you'll look back at your track record of obedience with Jesus and say, you know what? Like David, I slew a lion and a bear. I can handle this giant that seems to come across my path. David said, I'm not even going to mention their those gods, those idols. I'm not going to take up their names on my lips. And so we've looked at the perspective of a satisfied believer. He or she is a person that lives in God's presence. They live among God's people. And as we've seen in verse 4, they also live by godly principles. Now, the second thing I want to see in verses 5 and 6, what's not just the perspective of the satisfied believer, but what's the portion? Look at this in verse 5. He says, O Lord, and I love the way he starts that. That's a saying of passion. It's a saying of intimacy. I don't say that type of expression with many other people at all, except my wife, my kids. Oh, son. I just put my hand on his face. Oh, son, it's okay. David is just in that personal acquaintance with the Lord, and he's saying, oh, Lord, you are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain or you uphold my lot. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. David realized both his provision and preservation are in the Lord, and they come from the Lord. See, a portion is what is given or allotted to me, whether I take it or not. A cup is what I actually consume. It's what I appropriate as my own. So it's kind of like you and I saying, the Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 2 or 3, we've been given, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to read it actually because I know I'm going to blow it. It's right on the tip of my tongue, but I hate butchering the word of the Lord. So, yes, there we go. The Bible tells us that the Lord has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. That's your inheritance. That's what God has given to every single Christian, every spiritual blessing. And then verses 2 through 14 go on to outline what all those blessings are. Now, if I were to come to you right now and I were to say, you know what, I want to write you a check. Better yet, instead of writing you a check, I'm a millionaire and I'm a billionaire. Why not? We can make it up, right? I'm a billionaire. And so I can either write you a check for $10 million, or I can give you access to all of my resources. And it's so much more. That's your inheritance. Now, what you would do with that, that would be what David's referring to as his cup. See, it's interesting because after Israel had gone into the land of Canaan, every tribe received their inheritance except the tribe of Levi. They were the tribe that served in the sanctuary. And as part of their service to the Lord, they were allowed to eat a portion of the sacrifices. But God told Levi something he told no other tribe. He said, I'm not going to give you a physical land for your inheritance. I myself am going to be your inheritance. I'm going to be your everything. And that's where David saw himself. So my question to you tonight, are you enjoying? Are you taking advantage of all that God has given you in Him? I think there are times where our past tries to keep us, let me rephrase that. I think there are times where Satan tries to keep us anchored to our past. Maybe you've had a background that is steeped in shame. You did things that you don't even want to talk about. I know of a husband and wife team where whenever the husband plays rock and roll, he loves it and he wants his wife to enjoy it. And so he plays it. She goes, oh, shut that off. It's horrible. And he's like, what? And so she would eject the music. And so he'd put it back in. And he'd say, wait a minute. I don't want this to get into an argument. Sweetheart, I'm noticing there's some distress over rock and roll music. Why? And she said every time she listened to it, it would remind her of her past. I think some of us, the enemy wants to keep us anchored to our past so that we can't enjoy what the Lord has given us in Him. Are you enjoying that? That grace that's given to you in Christ? Are you enjoying the fact that your sins have been wiped away from you, the handwriting of requirements nailed to the cross, as Colossians tells us? Are you enjoying the fact that you can now walk with a joy and an expectation that you are going to heaven? See, I think sometimes those things can hold us back tonight. Even as I'm saying this, the Lord is bringing to your memory. Yeah, this is something that causes you shame. Don't let that happen anymore. Surrender that to Jesus tonight, because He paid for it. It's not just covered, waiting one day for somebody to find out about it. The Bible says He's cast your sin as far as the east is from the west. That's never to return again. And that's the grace and the power of our God. A.W. Tozer said, "The man who has God for his inheritance or treasure has all things in one. Many ordinary treasures may be denied them, or if they're allowed to have them, the enjoyment of them will be so tempered they'll never be necessary to their happiness. Or if they must see them go one after one, he'll scarcely feel a sense of loss. For having the source of all things, he has in one all satisfaction, all pleasure, all delight. Whatever he may lose, he's actually lost nothing, for he now has it all in one, and he has it purely, legitimately, and forever." I love that. I hope that describes us. He goes on and says, "You maintain my lot, and the lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Oh, yes, I have a good inheritance." So what David is saying here is his portion in the satisfied believer, as a satisfied believer, is one in the Lord spiritually, but then physically, materially, God maintained his possessions. Well, I think that's why it's good for us to hang on to them loosely. Hey, I remember years ago, my wife and I were, before we were married, actually, it was a date night. And so we came to this intersection, and there was this little sports car that got T-boned by this older couple in a Cadillac. The guy got out of it, and you could tell it was his world. He screamed, "Oh my God!" So he acknowledged it was his God. And then he got out, and he starts yelling at this older couple, and like, "Oh my goodness." And I'm like, "Hey, relax, man. It's going to burn one day anyways." And he's like, "Well, what?" I'll never forget that. Like, "What do you mean it's going to burn? It's T-bone, so not much to it now." But he didn't realize. That's the way it's good for us to have that same mindset. Let's look at verses 7 through 11, as we consider the path of the satisfied believer. Now look at what David is saying. "I'm going to bless the Lord who's given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I've set the Lord always before me. Because he's at my right hand, I shall not be moved." Let's actually stop right there, verses 7 and 8. There's three things that we see David is saying, "Man, I will bless the Lord." And there are three main reasons. Two sound pretty obvious, but the third you might be surprised at. He wants to bless the Lord. "Bless the Lord, O my soul." We need to remind ourselves of that at times, I think. He said, "This is something that I'm going to do." He didn't say whether if I feel like it. He didn't say, you know, when it's convenient for me. I will. Psalm 34, one of my all-time favorite psalms. "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth." Great psalm, great attitude. And that's why he was a satisfied believer. But the three reasons, the first thing I notice is he received courage from the Lord, and it came in the form of counsel. "The Lord has given me counsel." Because David was satisfied by God with his presence and his people and his principles, David experienced a personal fellowship with God that caused him to bless the Lord. And he received counsel and courage from that alone. But notice something else here. He says, "My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. Now we may look at that and say, well, I don't understand. Is David saying that God teaches him and then his heart equally teaches him what the Lord teaches? I don't think that's where he's coming from at all. Actually, the word instruct, David shows us that he learned that God also speaks to him through correction as well. The word instruct means to chasten, admonish, or discipline. And the word night is actually, in Hebrew, it's a plural. So it could be dark nights or night after night. God has disciplined me. God has chastened me. It's like at the long end of your day when you realize, I shouldn't have done that. When the Holy Spirit just, as you're driving home, convicts you. Or when you're spending that time and you're debriefing with the Lord at the end of your day, and the Lord is saying, hey, listen, we need to talk. That wasn't good. You are self-serving here. You are walking in pride. Do you realize what your words did to that person that you were talking to? And that's where David said, hey, sometimes the Lord teaches my heart to rehearse the day, to be disciplined so that, well, I think we all go through what St. John of the Cross, that Puritan mystic, referred to as the dark night of the soul. You have those times where you feel like, man, I'm all alone here. Lord, you even seem distant. Where are you? What's going on? Do you realize that David said, God even uses that in my life to speak to me because I know that he's here even when I don't feel like it. God spoke to David both day and nighttime. He was regularly spending time receiving the counsel from the law, from God's word. Remember in Psalm 119, he said, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. I think too many times God doesn't have the opportunity to speak to us because we don't open the word. You know why? Or we open the word only as a duty. Well, it's been 10 minutes, so all right, I'm good. Thanks, Lord. See you tomorrow. Let me recommend something to you. I like what George Mueller said. His counsel was, I saw more clearly than ever that the first great and primary business which I ought to attend every day was to have my soul happy in the Lord. Not how I might glorify the Lord, but how I might get my soul into a happy state. I saw that the most important thing I had to do was give myself to the reading of the Word of God and meditation on it. I love that. Now look at verses 9 through 11. He says, therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices, for my flesh will also rest in hope. You will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You'll show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Two things that David saw as his path. He saw in the next life how he was captivated by God. He was satisfied because he was rejoicing in the Lord. My heart is glad and my glory rejoices. But then in verses 10 and 11, he says, you're not going to leave me stranded. You're not going to leave me in Sheol. And Sheol in the Old Testament was kind of like this ambiguous netherworld. It referred to anybody who died. It was kind of like the Hades of the New Testament, but Sheol wasn't a place. It was a condition, the separation of the personality from the body. And it referred to anybody who died, believe it or not. Sheol was kind of a gray area after death. They weren't sure. But here David says, saying, I know I'm not going to be left hanging. He knew that God would deliver him from death. That's a metaphor for isolation or abandonment when he says, I'm not going to see corruption or decay. This was used obviously by Peter and Paul in the book of Acts. They shared that God would give Jesus not just a deliverance from death, but a resurrection from death once he was there. David ended on a high note. And this is what I want to leave us with. He knew that death was not the separation of his relationship with the Lord, because he knew that he would be, in verse 11, in his presence where there would be fullness of joy, and at his right hand, pleasures forevermore. Listen, the resurrection brings satisfaction to us as well in three areas. It guarantees that you and I will rise again. Because Jesus rose, we shall rise also. That's the first thing. The second thing is that the resurrection, and here's the hard truth, it guarantees future judgment as well. Listen, God wouldn't be a loving God to those who suffered under the evil of others if he didn't judge righteously. Acts 17:31 tells us about that. He appointed a day on which he'll judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained, Jesus Christ. And the last thing is that the resurrection guarantees power to live this life as believers. While there's no such thing as sinless perfection in reality, because of Jesus' resurrection, though, we can experience days where we sin less. So let me go back to the beginning. So we've kind of gone over a little bit of a checklist, the perspective of the satisfied believer, the portion of the satisfied believer, the path. How would you, if you were sitting here to say, here's my portrait, Lord, what do you show me? What would you say? What does that look like in your life tonight? And what are the things that the Lord is wanting to show you through this? To be a satisfied believer, you need to be hungry first and foremost for the things of the Lord. Tonight, I want to ask you, have you been consistently trusting in the Lord? Or do you feel like that kind of Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, trusting in the Lord, trusting in myself? Tonight, he wants that to be surrendered to him. Trust in him with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Let me ask you this, have you been living by godly principles? Or do you kind of live one way when you come here at church? You have your church face, you know, hey, how are you? God bless you. How's it going? And then afterwards, you get in the car and you're just like, totally different. I can't believe that guy cut me off, man. Maybe you've been captivated because death hasn't been able to separate you from God. Is that your hope tonight? Maybe you have a fear of death and the Lord says tonight, listen, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I don't know where you may be tonight, but hopefully you've gone from being hungry to being satisfied as the Lord has shown you some of these things. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we want to thank you for this time just speaking to us. Lord, this is that Psalm of David which he wanted to be remembered because these are things that you showed him. Lord, I pray that tonight those who are in here, that you would speak to them about living with that perspective of walking by faith. Lord, I pray for those who may have struggled in their relationship and their faith of looking to you. I ask, Lord, that you would speak to their hearts and cause them just to surrender. Whatever it is that's getting in the way between you and them, that they would say, Lord, no more. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I have enough of you to be miserable, but not enough of you to be joyful. Lord, I pray that you cause them to surrender right now. And if that's you here tonight, I'd love to pray for you. Can I pray for you right now as you say, man, I've been going back and forth. The Lord wants tonight just to have that end. Would you raise your hand? Would you say, Brent, I need prayer in that area because I'm not completely satisfied and it's been my own doing. Go ahead and hold up your hand wherever you may be right now. Hold it up. All right, I see you over there, you back there as well. Praise God. It's a great place to be. Nothing happens just by us raising our hand. It's the exercise of our will, surrendering to the Lord. Maybe you realize that you haven't been putting those safeguards in your relationship with the Lord. You've been kind of going down that slippery slope. And the Lord says, man, I want to set you free from that. Or you can't necessarily say that he is your portion. You haven't been enjoying all of your inheritance in the Lord. You keep saying, Lord, I want more of you. Lord, I want more of you. And God's response to you tonight is, you don't need more of me. You need less of yourself. Because that's what's getting in the way of us. And if the Lord is speaking to you about that right now, I would love to pray for you as well. The Lord's convicting you. Don't allow your pride to prevent you from reaching out to him. Raise your hand right wherever you are right now. You're saying, Lord, I've been not experiencing all that you have for me, but it's not because I need more of you, it's less of me. Can I pray for you? Would you raise your hand? Would you say, Brent, that describes where I am. All right, I see you as well. Over here also. It's a good place to be because it's not in our strength, but in our weakness that his strength is made perfect. Lastly, maybe you don't know Jesus and you're saying, I just need to come back to the Lord. I need to surrender my life to him. Can I lift you up as well? If you were to die right now, you wouldn't say for sure that you know you'd be in his presence. Maybe there's a fearful expectation you'd be away from his presence. Don't let any more time go by before you know for sure. Raise your hand right now. Let me pray for you. Let me lift you up to him. Anybody else? All right, Lord, thank you so much for our time, for your love for us. We ask so much that you would have your hand upon those who have raised their hands, that you would see their prayers, that you would see their response to you, and you would say, all is forgiven. I'm going to strengthen you. I'm going to build you up, but abide in me. Abide in the fellowship that I have for you. And watch going from hunger that's unsatisfied to a satisfaction that's found only in you. Lord, for those who recognize that it's not the need for more of you, but less of myself, less of my flesh, Lord, help us to have that contentment and help us to have that death to self. So, Lord, I just pray that you would forgive me for getting in your way, and that you would help me just to come to you again, to continue to surrender, continue to come to the cross. Thank you, Lord, for meeting us here. May you just go before our time of fellowship the rest of our night as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Thanks so much for having me out tonight.